Hello and welcome to Asian Voices. I'm your host, Kathleen Choi. We close our season with a special episode that explores how nonprofit organizations play a vital role in impacting change through building bridges of better awareness, understanding, and cultural literacy. We focus on two such organizations today and learn about the passionate individuals who are responsible for founding them. That and more coming up next on Asian Voices. As an inspiring author and humanitarian, Layli Hayslip has once been called a spy and a patriot. But one thing above all, she is a courageous survivor. We are honored to share Layli's incredible journey, beginning as a Vietnamese peasant farmer's daughter, caught up in the terrors of the Vietnam War, to where her life's path led her to the US, and eventually returning to her home years later. As a founder of the Global Village Foundation, Layli helped build schools and hospitals in poor villages in Vietnam to help those who still suffer even years after the war.
The past for everyone is full of missed chances, surviving to understand them. If not set them straight, it's one of the things that makes the next breath worth taking. I only say what I myself have learned, that life purpose is to grow. If we can do this personally, no matter how many others follow, our heart will at least find peace. Hating people who wronged me only keep me in their power. Forgiving them and thanking them for the lesson they taught me, on the other hand, set me free to continue on my way. I came from a very small village right outside of Da Nang. I'm the youngest of the daughter of six children. And I love to work on a farm. We are rice paddies, a farmer. I had quarter buffalo at a pass. I had duck, chicken, pig, cow, everything. But then war came early at 1960. Everything run upside down. And I lost my pass. Then I lost my brother who joins military and went to the north. Then I lost my father. Then I lost the whole village, everything. And I have two brothers. One that went to north in 1954, is the oldest. Then one is oldest next to me, and he went in 1961. Joined the Viet Cong and went to north. And the oldest went to north in 54. He survived the war, walked from north to the south. But the next to me, he was killed in 1968, the same year that I lost my father as well. And many years later, in 1992, I happened to win back and seek out the psychics and try to find his remains. They lead us to the his graveside, and we remove him. back to our village. And that is, I think, it brings my mother the happiest moment, you know, all of us. And he's not the only one, but I mean, you know, hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese, I say. A young girl like myself, we have to flee the village every night to go to where we can sleep and stay alive and, you know, get the torture and rape. But then I end up to be raped and be tortured many times. And at from 12 to 14 years old, in those 2 years, I've been in and out of prisons and torture camp and rape and all those things at only 14. And then finally, my family have to get the permission from all sides for me to get out of the village. Otherwise, I would be dead just like everyone else. So I escaped the village when I was 14 to further to Da Nang and to Saigon. You know, the choice that we had to stay there and die, that only choice. But because I'm the only one at home, my brother left, my sister gone. And for me to stay alive, I had to get out. And lucky me that I get out. But do I have whatever I have to do and to survive? I don't know where it came from. It just forced me to move on. I was 19, and I met my husband right on the street in Da Nang. And so we met, and we fell in love. We got married. He older than me. 1969 to 1970, May 1970, we all came home to San Diego. I knew nothing about America, and my husband brought me here. A good thing that we live with his mom, and so I learned a lot from her. But the cultural differences, the war going on in Vietnam, and with two children, young children, and with a big American husband who was older than me, not long after I got here, he passed away. And so another lesson I have to learn in a foreign land is to survive, take care of my two boys. Passed away a couple of years, then I met my second husband, Dennis Hayslip. And that, from the day we met, from the day he passed away, that total 8 years. So very short. I pay off my karma with my man, then I keep move on and take care of my kids. After my second husband passed away, I learned how to become a businesswoman. But it's tough as a single mother and as an Asian woman, and it's no job and skill. A lot of refugees start to come in 1975, Vietnamese. I help out the refugees and boat people. Then I decided to go back to Vietnam after 16 years in San Diego. I went back to my village and saw my mom and met my brother for the first time in 36 years. But what so good about it, I found my path to do a humanitarian relief work when people so much need it. And the country is so poor, you know? And I come here, I give up everything. I sold my restaurant, I sold many houses. And only thing I do is giving back to people. And people here think I'm a communist. And you know, they try to kill me here, they want to kill me here, they protest it, and again me boycott everywhere I go to talk about the raise the money and all that. And so I have a good life, live in between. Live in between the war, the peace, the American, Vietnam, and everything, you know. And you do right thing, heaven look down, take care of you. That's what I believe. And that's when I started a nonprofit foundation, Ismiquet, in 1988. When that very successful and accomplished everything I set up to do, I moved on to Global Village Foundation in 2000. Global Village Foundation not only built the schools, but also supply with the books for children to read. And if the children cannot come to school twice a day, at least they still can have books to read when they have free time. Thank you. only way that I can help Vietnamese people, only way that American or the readers can understand what we went through and how the country such a mess is to write a book and to tell what I know, to tell the story of little girl who grew up and witnessed and went through and whatever that I went through in life, to share with the others. Because American in those days did not want to hear about Vietnam or talk about it. But that title, it was from my mom. And she related to me that trời đất đổi thay con ơi. That means heaven and earth change places. And so the book came out, then one day Oliver Stone agents called my agent and said that he interested in option the book for the movie, for his trilogy for the Vietnam War. And that was when I learned about who Oliver was and about Hollywood, about the movie, and how much American appreciate to hear the voice on Vietnamese side. When we know each other more, I spend more time with him, at his house, with his family, but then we become a good friend, then it's easy to work with. Right after he optioned the books in 1989, we just, you know, break the ground to build a very first clinic by a U.S. Vietnam veteran who volunteers from here, California, to Vietnam. And we had no fun. And so the veterans wrote him a letter, a personal letter, and with me say, you know, ask him to see if he can help us. And he fund the whole project. And so I funded what set up everything inside, but he fund for the building. And so that is the very first project. It's called Mother Love Clinic in my village. And that is the healing, and that is just like the very first opening, the communication between U.S. and Vietnam. And that was in 1989. And that is why I think Oliver is meant to be. And you're talking about the soulmate or whatever in the past. We did it.
If I could, I would have stopped you from going to America. What would have happened to your sons here? I'm so proud of you, buddy. You've grown up to see the side of things that's hidden from most people. Tears are God's way of paying you back for what he's taken.
I cannot be done on the thing that have been done for the last 40 years without support and help and deep gratitude to all those who volunteers and who donated and who, you know, make a contribution and travel with me to work in Vietnam, around the world. And now that I would like to, you know, continue to ask for support and help, of course, many young people need to really learn how to run an NGO. And if anybody interested, support or volunteer or make a contribution, please go into my website at globalvillagefoundation.org. I able to create a nice garden, plants many, many herbs and passion fruit and dragon fruit and all that. So I spend a few hours in the morning and a few hours in the evening in my garden. And the rest of it, I read, meditate, listen to what Buddha's teaching and learning more about life. Thinking about where would I go after here? I know who I am, where I'm coming from, what I'm doing here. Be a good enough soul to go into a spiritual world. I am Hwang Lely Hayslip. This is my voice.
Welcome back. Once known as the Hermit Kingdom, South Korea has evolved to become one of the most successful economies in Asia and in promoting its culture and food to the West. Let's meet with JJ Hwang, who has dedicated herself for over 10 years in bringing her passion for her culture to San Diego through the House of Korea project that is part of the International House of Cottages in Balboa Park. We had a chance to experience the opening ceremony and enjoy a K-pop concert in celebration of Korea Day in San Diego.
Tremendously important thing to have a place where we can showcase Korean culture in the beautiful Balboa Park. My name is Jeongju Hwang, you can call me JJ. I'm a founder and president of House of Korea. So we are actually celebrating the opening of House of Korea cottage today.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1!
House-Pacific relations and all of the international cottages remain the same today as it was in 1935. To present cultural programs for education and entertainment for San Diego's residents and visitors, and to foster and cultivate a spirit of tolerance, understanding, and goodwill among all the cultures represented here. So today, let us celebrate tomorrow's India, Korea, Mexico, Palestine, Panama, Peru, Philippines, and Turkey.
House of Korea is a non-profit organization where we want to be a cultural ambassador of our beloved country, Republic of Korea, to the San Diego community and to the world. I have visited Balboa Park several times because there are so many museums and gardens, etc. I came across to the small cottages, which they exhibit their culture during the weekend. So obviously, when I look at the sign of a House of USA, House of England, etc., House of China, and I was looking for a House of Korea, I found that there is no House of Korea. So that was a starting of my initiative to build the House of Korean nonprofit organization in 2012. We realized that this is our last chance to have our physical location in the beautiful Balboa Park. So we started to initiate the House of Korea cottage project in 2015 December. We are different because we did the grassroots fundraising, and we basically built this house by the help of all the generous donors and then the members of House of Korea. So after we become a member of House of Pacific Relationship, now we can showcase our culture, history, everything at the event. And more importantly, because now we do have this cottage, we can show our culture every weekend throughout the year in this Balboa Park, where there are so many visitors from around the world. I am JJ Hwang. This is my voice.
This program was made possible in part by the California Arts Council, advancing California through the arts and creativity. Team Metro Real Estate, helping families with real estate investments in San Diego since 1990. Contact us today for your free in-home market valuation. Promote your organization or event online today on Asian Pacific Community Connection Business Directory website. Asian Voices was brought to you by Asian Culture and Media Alliance, empowering our Asian and Pacific Islander communities through media arts since 2013.
Please support the only television program
that creates a voice of real change.
Asian Voices.
Asian Voices.
Asian Voices.
Asian Voices.
Asian Voices.
Asian Voices.
This is our voice.
Well, that's all for today's show, but be sure to check out our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Before I go, I'll leave you with today's music video by an upcoming talented API music artist. I'm Kathleen Choi, and I'll see you next season on Asian Voices. Until then, take care, everyone.
Ooh, okay, let's go. All right, let's get this party started. Watch. Oh, new K-drama, let's check this out.
All of this time that I've been waiting for you, finally, the girl I see is now here with me as my baby. Oh, you're looking so fly,
so fly.
You got me so alive.
Favorite show.
I binge whenever I'm at home.
Every single episode.
Of-